Connecticut State, a program that only went Division I in 86, and a couple of years ago, they won four basketball games. Howie Dickeman, the former Jim Calhoun assistant at Connecticut, goes back to his alma mater, and nice rebuilding job as they come in as champs out of their conference. Obviously a heavy, heavy underdog, and they were blown right out of the box early part of this game by the powerful Cyclones, a very popular Final Four pick. Jamal Tinsley to Pfizer, and Pfizer, the player of the year. That conference was on fire early, but you can see at the end of the half there, Thomas Brookins beats the clock with the three. It was only nine at the break. Iowa State only a six-point game when Pfizer knocks down the triple. He would have a monster game. Cyclones back up nine. Next possession, Tinsley. Crossover. Love his game. New York City guard out of the AAU program there. Never played high school basketball, but Iowa State found him. Comes out of the junior college ranks. Very underrated player, but you can see Central Connecticut cuts it back down to a two-point game and pushes the ball. Dean Walker feeds Mickens for the lay-in, tied at 69 with 6:10 to play. Iowa State would finally begin to pull away. Horton to Michael Nurse, who knocks down a very big and very deep three. And the second seed in the Midwest Regions hang on in Minneapolis for a 10-point win.
Well, this is one of these games where you jump out, you're Iowa State, you jump out 26-8. Pfizer's got 15 of those 26 points. And the next thing you know, a guy named Joe Tice gets Central back in the game in the first half. He has 10 points.
But Creighton, another team that looked to be out of this game early on. Doc Robinson, behind the back, knocks down the shot. Auburn led by eight. They would build the lead, but then Creighton would come back because they're a great three-point shooting team. Justin Haynes gets the Blue Jays back within one. Then Auburn almost turns over, but Mac McGadney still had nine on the shot clock, but he drilled the line drive three-pointer. That was Auburn's biggest shot of the game. So Jimbo Tolbert enters the game. He's a student manager. Everybody's excited. Oops. It's not over, folks. Not a nine-point game with 12 seconds to go. They had to pull it back out. Put the more experienced guys back in there. This three draws within three at 3.8 to go. That's after Sears knocked the shot down. Taylor hit the three, and then the turnover. Dana Altman tries to figure a way to get a good look. Instead, they kind of force it to the corner. Good defense by Auburn. They didn't buy the screen there. They defended well off that. And Cliff Ellis' team, a huge sigh of relief as they march on.
You got to give Creighton credit. They start the game shooting 4 for 14 in the threes, 28% in the first half.
Kentucky fans certainly not well acquainted with what a challenge the Bonnies might be. Ask folks like Temple. The Owls went down to St. Bonaventure, but Bonnies would have to be hitting the threes today to make this a fact. This was just a terrific basketball game. Tayshaun Prince nails the triple from the wing. Five threes for Prince. That tied the game at 63. Bonaventure had much of the lead down the stretch here. Then Tim Wynn, the little point guard, out of control, misses the shot. Camera there for the rejection. We go to overtime. In OT. Watch the circus layup by Wynn, and he draws the foul. Jim Barron's team fighting. David Messiah Capers is fouled by the freshman Marvin Stone behind the line. The freshman mistake. And Capers, a 55% free throw shooter, knocks down the first one. Tubby calls time. After the timeout, knocks down the second one. Another timeout trying to ice the poor free throw shooter. But he defies the odds and goes 3 for 3 with 0.4 seconds to go. Barron's team forcing a second overtime. Watch this. This is just bad luck for the Bonnies. Bogans cleans up the garbage as the ball was tipped away in the lane for the lead. Wynn around the screen. Could not get the three to go down. He was just 1 of 10 from behind the line. The Bonnies as a team shoot very poorly from three-point land. And Kentucky, a huge sigh of relief for Smith. Another tight battle here. And Jason Hart will pick up the loose ball. Cuse running. Sean Williams gets it back to Hart for the lay-in, and the Cuse led by 11. This follows a familiar pattern. The Power Conference team kind of grabbing an early lead and seeming to be in control before the little guys rally. Reed Rawlings, the triple is good, his fourth in the first half. Rawlings again, this time the offensive rebound. Samford down 7 at halftime, hanging around. Second half, Syracuse trying to pull away. Blackwell, great bounce pass here for Eton Thomas, and the Cuse up by 10. Then the good ball move by Samford. This is what they like to do here.
Playing those, Samford likes to move the ball, reverse it, and shoot the three. Unfortunately, they weren't able to have a big, big day shooting the trifecta. Like
got within three there, though. And then the turnover here. Brown, the steal, baseball pass to Hart. Back to Blackwell, the trailer. And Syracuse pulling away late for the 14-point win.
Well, you know, experience, experience, experience. And that was the difference in that game. Blackwell, Thomas, and certainly Hart. And then you talk about Jimmy Boeheim. And his next matchup, he's got Mr. Kentucky, baby, and Tubby Smith. And I'll tell you this, Lexington has been beautiful to Mr. Boeheim. His wife, Julie's from there, and she's an absolute superstar. So I can tell you this, Mr. Boeheim and company with that 2-3 zone, Digger, they're going to challenge Kentucky and make Kentucky make perimeter shots.
With Texas against Indiana State, well, Rick Barnes has certainly had his troubles at various schools in the first round, just a 1-6 record coming in. Texas worried about nerves, frankly, against Indiana State. Chris Mim hoping to make a run here. Mim sets up the screen there, but Indiana State plays a nice defense, steps around him, denies him the basketball. Still trouble getting the ball inside to Mim here. Gabriel Conti, good defensive position.
Good job playing it, playing a post, putting ball pressure, and I get a turnover trying to get inside to Chris Mim.
They really did a great job, Chris, really collapsing inside. But early in the game, they were making threes. They made 5 out of 8 in their first threes, Texas.
That was Darren Kelly as Mim set the screen. Then Mim gets the ball on the block and also draws the foul. He would finish with 16, and Chris Owens had a big second half. Owens, the offensive putback. Gabe Benecki now will drive. Dish to Owens for the dunk. And that same combination hooks up again. Benecki, lob inside for Owens. Nice ball game, and Barnes does clear the first round hurdle, a 16-point win over Indiana State.
You got to credit Texas' patience with their inside game because Mim, Owens, and Benecki combined for 48 points. The three of them had 16 apiece, but Owens was the guy going 7 for 7 from the field. Really impressed with his game at 6.
Did not play anybody all season long and went to the NCAA tournament. They did not have a single power conference opponent, so very tough to get a read on them. Antonio Short gives LSU a read, knocking down the triple there. Bechera misses, it's bobble around. Stromile Swift will tie the game at 38 midway in the second half. You can tell low scoring, kind of grind it out kind of game. Roderick Johnson, the shot, draws the foul, missed the free throw. Indians by one. LSU, next time down the floor, Bechera to Swift, and he does his Vince Carter impression. Indians, answer, Branson. Strong two-handed dunk. He went right by Swift.
I'll tell you, I was impressed with him. He really played well. So did Johnson.
There's a big shot, Dick. You talked about it. Torres Bright knocking down the triple to tie the game. And then he waits for the defender to fly by, and Brian Bechera knocks down the triple. Three-point game. Can the Indians get a good shot in the final 10 seconds? Johnson picks up the loose ball. The heave is off the front rim. The iron unkind, and the Bayou Bengals advance 64-61.
Gary Gardner did a solid job with that club defensively all year. They were 24-6. You mentioned the fact that he didn't play any of the big boys. They never get a chance. I tell you, he can get on the phone all day, call everyone up, and I can guarantee you they will not allow them to play, especially after seeing what they did today. Very impressive performance against an outstanding basketball team because, as we know, LSU's been outstanding all year. And I'll tell you who's underrated. Diaper Dandy, we never hear his name, is Taurus Bright. Made a big three. Bechera, the transfer from out of Rice, made a big play. And John Brady's club. Hey, who would have ever thought when the season started, come on, raise your hand now. Nobody can raise their hand. That LSU would still be alive in the top 32 in America.
They're very lucky to be alive, though, man.
Well, Southwest
Missouri
State.
I'd rather be lucky, man, lucky.
See, there's an enlarged team shows that they're one of the last teams in. We finally get our first upset of the day. Well, you can see the follow there. The Cardinal missed, but McQuay is there for the dunk. The Boilermakers led by 7 in the first half. Time ticking down here. Cunningham misses the jumper, and Brian Cardinal just beats the buzzer with a putback. Very close first half. Boilers trying to pull away here, but Tony Stanley draws them back within 3 by knocking down the triple inside of the final 5 minutes. Now, 3 minutes to go. Brooks, Hall, the steal, and the lay-in. And Dayton has a 3-point lead in the final 3 minutes, but the Boilers respond. Jerron Cornell knocks down the triple to tie the game. Final minute or so. Cardinal around the corner. They lose him out there, and he makes some pay, and Purdue's up by 3. Now to the final 7 seconds. Brooks Hall at the line. Flyers down by 1, and the foul shot rims out. Cardinal grabs the rebound. They call a foul on Dayton after the rebound. Last chance here, still a 1-point game. And Mop's shot does not go. And Purdue holds on for the one-point win.
Purdue comes in with a two-game losing streak. They lose their final game of the year at Indiana, losing the first round of Wisconsin in the Big Ten tournament 78-66. So
you're a 14 seed. They get on the Sooners. Lost their last two trips to Tucson. Of course, they weren't playing Winthrop when they went in there. First half, Oklahoma in control. Eduardo Najera brought a bunch of fans from Mexico. Popular guy in Tucson this weekend for the finish, and Oklahoma's out early. Then Najera hits the runner, and he finished with only 10 points. They spread the scoring around. The Sooners will build a big lead here. A lot of guys a chance to get in there. Najera to J.R. Raymond to win scoreless in the Big 12 championship game, but to kind of get off the schneid this afternoon. And Price buries the three from the corner. He had 10. Oklahoma by 16 at the half, and this is one game where the underdog team is really not going to make a run. They turn up the defense here. Najera, the rejection against Greg Lewis. Oklahoma beating the pressure. Tim Heskett wide open, knocks down the triple from the corner. Heskett again with the three-point shot. Oklahoma suffocating Winthrop with the defense and hitting their shots. And this one of the few laughers in the afternoon. They went at 74-50.
But a plus for Oklahoma, J.R. Raymond, who did not score in the championship game on Sunday in Big 12. He comes back today with 14 points.
Home game for them facing St. John's. St. John's, a very popular team coming into the tournament. A lot of people see this squad going to the Final Four, but they would have to face 7-footer Dan McClintock, 4 inches taller than St. John's tallest player. He turns around with a jumper there. Northern Arizona only down by 3 at halftime, 28-25. Then St. John's gets tough defensively. Watch Barkley pick the pocket here, apply the pressure. And they get the 10-second violation. Great defensive play by Eric Barkley. Minutes later, more St. John's in defense. Barkley with the steal, goes in, lays it up and in. St. John's at that point had a 9-point lead, but Northern Arizona will not die. Off the inbound pass, Ross Land with a 3-pointer, one of the best 3-point shooters in the country, within two. And then Corey Schwab kills another Schwab as he nails that three, and Northern Arizona takes a 1-point lead. And 15 seconds left. LeVar Postel, look at that move, and gets fouled. St. John's takes a 3-point lead. Northern Arizona with another chance. Barkley knocks away the ball, gets fouled, but unfortunately for Northern Arizona, didn't even send him to the line because they had fouls to give, so St. John's survives.
Barkley goes 0 for 5 in the first half, plays the defense, second half comes up with 8 big points, but Glover making that one-on-one move to score to get the lead. St. John's comes away with his big win.
No, that was Bill Postella made the big play there, but it was Bootsy Thornton with 20 points and 7 rebounds who was sensational. Their backcourt outstanding. But remember this, Northern Arizona out of the Big Sky. Last year, the Big Sky, it was Weber State, shocking America, beating North Carolina.
Now Gonzaga, a number 10 seed in the West, just like last year when they went to the Elite Eight. Ryan Floyd off the screen, knocks down a three. And then the Zags possession. Matt Santangelo leaves it for Richie Fromm, who buries the three. Zags down only by one against Louisville. But then in the first, still the turnover there. Moving the other way, Nate Johnson leads the way to Maven, who lays it up and takes it in as Louisville takes a 1-point lead at halftime. Then in the second half, Denny Crum, wow, would be upset. And here's why, Dick. The Zags, lots of turnovers, but Louisville simply did not convert.
Oh, what a great defensive play. Richie Fromm with the hustle play of the night, Digger.
And then Santangelo takes it the other way, finds Fromm, and
count it.
Better guard him. Knocked it down. 31 points for Fromm. And then the back door to Casey Cavalry, and the Zags win it 77-66. This was the only lower seed to win the game today, and this game was not an upset.
Okay, no upset at all. When
you had to think they'd do a little better than that. Courtney Alexander, leading scorer in the nation, right? You wouldn't know it to see that one off the iron there.
I'll tell you, he was under control all day. Mike Kelly's an outstanding defensive guy, one of my premier defensive players in America, and he kept Courtney really in check. In fact, at one time, he was 4 for 19.
Yeah, he finished up 5 of 19 and 11 points, and then Kelly with the steal. Nice hesitation, lays it up, and in Wisconsin has a 1-point lead. More batters. Andy Kowski gets the land, and then senior guard John Bryant takes over, and for some reason, they stay in the zone.
I'll tell you, they stay in that 2-3 zone. Big wide gap. John Bryant says, give me the rock, baby. Nothing but nylon. Give it to me again. four in a row. He nailed seven. Jerry, get out of the zone, baby. Digger, he's got to come out of that zone.
He could have gone man, could have gone 1-2-2 zone to play the wings, but he didn't. Cost them because they shoot the threes. Great comeback for Wisconsin. They're behind. Made a big run at the end of the game. Unbelievable how they pulled this off on that 26-4 run with 9:30 left in that game.
I'll tell you something else, Digger. Think about this. They've only lost one game, guys, in their last one team, in their last 11. The only one to beat them, Michigan State, three times.
This is what happened last year. This is this year. But I feel that what really broke down was when Wisconsin got hot, when they lost to Indiana. They were down 12. With 11 minutes going to get to come back and win it. And next thing you know, they went two games of Big Ten Conference Tournament. But against Michigan State, they were down 19, cut it to five. And this is the momentum they carried in tonight's game against Fresno.
63 attempts from the field.
Unbelievable.
It is amazing. All right, let's look at this one. And of course, Lauren Woods could not play for Arizona against Jackson State. Michael Wright, though, played tough underneath. He had 19 points. Then Vincent Jones with a tough turnaround jumper while he's double-teamed. Tigers within two late in the first half. Jackson State band. You know they're going to lead the nation in band coverage. Richard Jefferson nails a jumper from the inside of the top of the key. He had 14 points. Then Deion Burns misses the layup, but Vincent Jones is there to jam it home. Then Burns with the steal. Back to Lawrence Myers. Touch pass back to Burns. Tigers within 12. They'd get it down to eight, but Arizona simply too much. And the freshman guards again. Gilbert Arenas with a three. And then Arenas once again for the three.
Arenas really solid, but credit the defense of Arizona. The last 10 minutes of this game, they held Jackson State to three field goals.
You know, Gardner didn't have a big game. Gardner, my National Player of the Year.
And a lot of people loving the Bruins, making that run. Now that Jerron Rush is back, Earl Watson, the lob to Jerron Rush. Haven't lost the game with him in the lineup. 6-0. Patrick Jackson outside, squares up, knocks down a three. Cardinals up 26-22 at halftime. Watson then the lob to Jerome Muiso, who sneaks in with one hand. Bruins down by four. Then Watson, the lob to Gazurk. How about that catch, Digger?
Side going to Gazurk, points in the paint big time.
And Watson looking for Capono for three.
Capono doesn't score in the first half, comes out and hits two threes back-to-back, gets 17 points in the second half, and he's a difference in UCLA in his late run.
That was Rush from outside, and then a Rush again for a three, 15-2 run. Make that 7-0 with Jerron Rush in the lineup.
I'll tell you, I love UCLA. I think Steve Lavin's got to get a lot of credit. But in fact, this club was a disappointing team in the middle of the year. They played without Jerron Rush. They're unblemished with him in the lineup. He gives them that athlete, that high riser. They got size. They got quickness. If they get consistent play out of Watson, they will be tough to beat.
And they also got defense because being down four at halftime, they come out the second half, and Ball State shoots 3-for-13 because of UCLA's strong, aggressive man defense.
Iona against Maryland. The Terps with starting guard Danny Miller on the bench. Ankle problem. Didn't miss him that much. Juan Dixon had a great game. Baseline jumper there. Little early lead. Jeff Rulin saying it wasn't like this when I was in the NBA. Juan Dixon knocking that one down. Terrace Morris from the outside. And then Jason Young to Cresta. Gets the layup, throws it down. 8-0 run for Iona, right back in it. And later, Maryland in transition. Where's the defense? Martisic gets the easy layup and in. Second half, more Terps. With Blake, who did a great job subbing in there. Finds Morris with a jam. Morris with 22. The Terps win going away.
They just jump out. It's about 60-32 midway through the second half. Lonnie Baxter, big.
Conference USA, and Rick Majerus knew he'd been in for a long night. Two bunched up here. Panel Medela cannot grab the pass. Out of bounds, the turnover. Scored only 3 points in the last 7.5 of the first half, and trailed 22-19. John Redden, nice little spin move down the lane, drops it in. Billikens up by two. 1:49 left. Billikens by one. Shot clock is winding down. Jeff Johnson, how about that shot?
That's his only basket of the game. What a trifecta.
Jensen looking for the kind roll, won't go. Dave Ferguson will have a shot for a three-pointer in the tie, perhaps overtime.
Wide open look.
Majerus is now 9-0 in first-round tournament games.
I'll tell you, they're going to do a great job containing Justin Love, who was sensational in Conference USA's tournament.
Yeah, he only had 5 points first half, 9 for the game. So the Love boat sank tonight. Utah wins it. But I'll tell you, you got to shoot better than 39% if you got to go up against Michigan State.
Unfortunately, Justin Love will be remembered for his bang against Kenyon Martin. Martin out of the tournament. This Valpo against Michigan State. Good defense. The long alley-oop pass to Jason Richardson. He skies and jams it down. Michigan State by 17.
Just a mismatch. Eminemer. Michigan State too physical, too quick, too strong, too explosive. Just too many good players.
The team cleaves with that drive. And then Morris Peterson, the drive and the foul. He goes high off the glass. Free throw was good. 3-point play. Peterson at 12. Michigan State wins 65-38.
Yeah, the no glass slipper in this Valparaiso team. They start the game out 1-for-15.
Ducks, they felt slighted by the committee down there at a 7 seed, looking for their first NCAA tournament win.